Welcome to Behavior Change Strategies. This is Lecture C. The objective for this lecture is to design individual behavior change interventions. So this is for those of you who are in the workforce and are trying to get an organization, such as a school, a health system, or some other organization, to create an intervention program. Methods for designing individual change interventions include identifying existing patient engagement programs, using patient-reported outcomes to tailor interventions for the population, and potentially using mobile technologies to improve patient engagement. In designing patient-centered interventions, we do not recommend you start from scratch. Many people are working on this problem in a variety of settings. You should really go to the internet and search very specifically related to either the disease, the population, or the setting that you're working in, and actually type in the words, quote, patient-centered, unquote, and you're likely to get much better resources and outcomes, including the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services office, which often has some best demonstrated practices you may want to look into. With that said, what do you need for designing patient-centered interventions? Well, you need a method, a process, and tools. Oftentimes, these tools are for things like teaching patient self-management that you will want to draw down from other places where they've been vetted, tested for their language clarity, for example, and are already known to be successfully fielded. More and more, we see patient engagement in mobile-based technologies, either through cell phones, smartwatches, computers, etc. And this also enables a great deal more self-monitoring to occur, and that's worthwhile. Another thing that many organizations are moving toward is creating more population-level interventions. And this is where they're actually starting to think about groups of people rather than individual patients, to try and see if they can deliver care in a more efficient, effective, and hopefully even more pleasant setting. So we see lots of group interventions and those sorts of things. The last thing we're seeing a bit of a revolution in is patient-provider communications. The internet, emails, patient portals, personal health records, all of these communication media are actually improving patient-provider interactions fairly dramatically. On this slide is an exhibit that demonstrates where people are working most actively as of 2013. One is chronic disease management, diabetes, asthma, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, etc. These are very serious chronic illnesses that people need to improve on dramatically. Another is medication adherence. You would be surprised how many people do not take medications as they're prescribed, and they may do this for a variety of reasons. The medication has unpleasant side effects. The medication may be expensive, and we see something called pill splitting, where the person will reduce their dosage by half. Another common medication adherence issue is people start to feel better and will cease the medication rather than completing the course of treatment as prescribed. Particularly for things like antibiotics, this can be damaging. Another big area is post-care management. As part of the value-based purchasing that's been discussed elsewhere in the ONC-HIT curriculum, we are no longer paying organizations when patients are readmitted. Therefore, post-acute care, meaning after discharge, is often a very active area that health systems in particular are trying to improve. We suspect you'll see the amount of post-acute care management increasing dramatically in the near future. One hopeful sign is preventive care practices, such as screenings, immunizations, etc., are on the rise. It's always good for those of us in public health, and that's why public health interventions are mentioned next. Things like smoking cessation, weight loss, and those sorts of bad habits that we're always trying to get people to reduce, and good habits that we're always trying to get them to increase. And lastly, wellness activities. Often we see these being employer-based activities. Employers are one of the payer groups that often take care of actually underwriting the health care that most of us receive. Therefore, wellness is of key interest to those types of organizations. Most tools are designed for particular types of care engagement or patient engagement, and these include care processes post-discharge. This might be continuity of care, where we're trying to make sure that the person gets to see the social worker, or that they're going back to their primary care physician after discharge, those sorts of interventions. We also see programs that are fairly closely related to the facility emergency rooms, and trying to keep those people from coming back to the emergency room repeatedly when they don't truly have an emergency condition. Those are very expensive ways to treat people, and there's often a better setting. So often, we're trying to move them from one facility to a more efficacious treatment location. Again, this goes back to the organizational type. There's something called the patient-centered medical home, and this is actually taking in a larger swath of providers than just medical groups. The PCMH, or patient-centered medical home, is often based out of medical offices, where accountable care organizations, ACOs, are often focused on hospitals and health systems. When you hear those two programs, a lot of that is trying to increase the value. And when you start to search for programs, you might think about PCMHs or ACOs as a starting point to find great demonstrations. We've talked several times about disease or specific behaviors. Diabetes is a very serious illness. Coronary illnesses, cardiovascular illnesses, and cancer are some of the big ones that you often hear people discuss. And again, if you'll search on those specific terms, you'll often see very good programs that have already been created. They may even have some forms of either financial or technical support that they will give you if you make contact with them. So don't recreate the wheel if you don't have to. A few different patient engagement strategies that we often see being undertaken with greater and greater regularity are community engagement, where we're trying to provide health education, healthy cooking classes, physical education, the use of patient navigators or wayfinders, where actually you, as the patient, call up a navigator and say, quote, "Here's the state of health or wellness I'm in. Where should I go in order to seek care more effectively?" unquote. And we, as healthcare organizations, may actually assign navigators to patients to help make sure that they have that outreach and support going forward. Organizations, both employers and health systems, are doing more and more, using volunteers and advocates, trying to remove restrictions in the hospital so that the family can come. Often, at time of discharge, for example, the patient may be coming out of sedation and may not have good memory or recall at this particular moment. Having a family member or someone else who can help make those discharge instructions and act on them in the following days can be very powerful. Although we've often been reticent to have families in the hospital because of a variety of reasons. Forming more cohesive or coherent healthcare teams where the primary care physician, the hospitalist, the nurses, the social workers, and other community agents are more engaged. And lastly, the individual. We're truly empowering individuals with more and more information on the internet and through sources such as this. Again, don't recreate the wheel. Use the internet. It's your friend. Other people who've had successful programs want to share their programs, want to share their expertise and experiences. So don't go it alone. Typing in, quote, patient engagement programs, unquote, and, quote, patient-centered care, unquote, are two very good places to start your searches. And then you can build more teams into those search engines as you go. There are also a few other reports that have been published. The Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality, AHRQ, has a guide to patient and family engagement you may want to look at. Health Affairs produced a special issue, and the American Hospital Association also has guides. These are fairly dynamic sites. Don't take these as being the end-all by any means. They're continually being added to, changed, and updated to show the best state-of-the-art in terms of management. Now let's turn for just a few moments to talking about measurement essentials. Patient engagement measures should include assessments of the patient's knowledge, and the caregiver's knowledge may also matter, confidence, and skills to prevent and manage chronic disease and other behaviors are critical. In particular, health information technology provides a lot of tools, more and more every day. We mentioned in another lecture the Cochrane Collaborative, which has best demonstrated practices. You can use those resources, etc. So let's talk a little bit more about this technology. Consumer adoption of personal health information technology, or PHIT, is accelerating dramatically. Fitbit, which is a particular brand, can measure heart rate, how many flights of stairs someone has gone up and down in a given day, average heart rate, etc. And that's really giving people the power to change some of their behaviors, to try and walk up the stairs more often rather than take the elevator, to try and walk around the block rather than cut through the building. And people are using those technologies with greater and greater regularity. There are expectations for real-time access. We see more and more clinics being open on weekends and after normal working hours in order to accommodate individuals. Those are changes in your organization you may wish to consider. There's a lot of pressure on the providers to embrace value-based payment systems. And again, the policy world is changing dramatically. The Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services control Medicare and Medicaid, which are the two largest payers, and they're only paying for value-based care more and more. So let's discuss a couple of technical terms on patient health IT. One term you're going to see a great deal of is something called mHealth, or mobile platforms, particularly if you're outside the U.S., where people are more reliant on their mobile phones to conduct other forms of activities, like banking. When people are connected to businesses and institutions through their phone, they're also more likely to use mHealth or applications on those phones to increase their ability to manage their own health. A couple of notable examples here in the U.S. are Kaiser Permanente, which is largely based on the West Coast, although it does also have East Coast operations. They now give all their patients access to their electronic health records, EHRs, and you can even download it onto your mobile device. In 2016, Apple's App Store had over 20,000 applications currently available, everything from exercise and diet to healthy vacations, applications where you can take pictures of your dinner plate and it will tell you how many calories it thinks you're consuming, etc. We're really in a rapidly changing and dynamic era for mHealth, and it's something you might build a program around because it's very easy for programs to build their own apps that help connect the consumer back to your organization or your program. So this is a very important part for the government. The Stage 3 Meaningful Use, which was a government program, will also have criteria focused on improving health outcomes, and that includes engaging patients in decision-making. So what are some of the patient engagement technologies? As mentioned earlier, email is an obvious one. The ability to schedule appointments without having to make the phone call and go back and forth can be very useful. Virtual visits, sometimes referred to as telehealth, are where you might use an application like Skype and talk to your doctor that way. Those have great promise, and more of the insurance companies and payers are now compensating the doctors for those types of virtual visits, which is likely to help reduce one barrier to doctors adopting those. Convenient self-services, such as finding a physician's office that's open and can see you quickly, managing your prescription refills. Some patients can get their prescriptions mailed to their house, and when the pharmacy thinks the patient is running out, the patient gets a text message and only has to reply, quote, yes, unquote, to get a refill. That really reduces some of the barriers to patients adopting that or following that medication regime because they no longer have to go to the drugstore and wait for the pharmacist to fill the prescription. Other personal health information that you're going to see more and more of is patients using their outpatient and inpatient clinical data to change how they act daily. And their daily activity may be fed back into that personal record. So that's where we see this, quote, enter or track personal data, unquote. Financial capabilities include being able to view and pay clinical bills online. Many people don't know what services cost. Therefore, you're getting a better estimate of what you're doing prospectively, so people aren't unhappy when they get the bill. You can also dispute bills more readily, actually look at what you paid for, and those sorts of things. A few other things that are on the forefront as we increase our use of information are education and support. YouTube and other outlets have not merely hundreds but thousands of video lectures that you may wish to go look at. And patients are already using those. With that said, some are better than others. We need to train people to be discerning consumers of such information, and also how to use peer and community support. So again, the general capabilities for patient engagement and technology are increasing dramatically, and it's something we should be very hopeful for as we go forward. This concludes Lecture C of Behavior Change Strategies. In summary, there are best practices in patient engagement. You should actively seek those out and actually try to talk to the people who are using those things, and they may help you. Many tools are specific to care settings or disease types, so you should be able to search for those and find a much more fruitful search if you think about your keywords carefully. There are numerous types of health information technologies that are already available. You may want to use those.